show contains mature content. Listener discretion is advised.
Are you ready to get your mind blown?
One angry New York City Puerto Rican decided to start a radio show. Determined to piss the world off.
Determined?
By shoving a mirror in front of society's face. He kicked them in the balls.
What are you? Who are you?
This is the Crotch Shot Radio Show. Crotch Shot Radio Show.
This is not a test. This is a broadcast transmission.
We're going to stay on the air.
And now, the weepy, the weepy.
Yo, welcome to the Crotch Shot Radio Show, where we kick the issues in the balls. We're on an active war against bullshit. We would do anything and everything to expose bullshit. The ends sometimes justify the memes. So if you're angry and want the truth exposed, then strap in and prepare to be shocked. This is Smash Mouth Talk. If you can't accept that, then fuck off. I'm your host, Louis B. I takes no bullshit from nobody. I actually expose the bullshit of society and chop it up into easy-to-digest chunks for you. Today won't be any different. Today, I am honored to have Miss Marie Christie on the show. We're going to be talking about mental illness and the how it's stigmatized and how it's ignored. And Christie, how you doing?
I'm great. How are you doing?
I'm okay. What's going on in the background?
That's what I was worried about. I was in the process of transitioning myself.
Oh.
I'm actually driving.
Oh, you're driving.
Yeah, but I'm getting ready to pull over. So,
oh, okay.
And then I drive a Jeep, so it's like nothing but background. So,
oh,
air. Yeah, sorry.
That's okay.
Is it bad?
No. Well, we'll soldier through it. I will just pump up some background music for us.
Okay.
There we go. Nice little relaxing, chill out EDM. So, yeah, you contacted me via Instagram today, and I watched some of the interview that you were on another podcast. Why don't you tell people your story from the beginning?
Well, I have a 23-year-old. He just turned 23 yesterday, actually. So,
mazel tov.
He was diagnosed with schizophrenia at 18. Clinically depressed, which is, it's not like your everyday depression. It's, like something bad happening at work and you go home and you're sad. This is something, this is going to be an everyday thing for the rest of his life. So we've been struggling with it since he was 18. And so, we've hit a lot of bumps in the road. We've had a lot of good times, but we've had a lot of, I was worried when I sent you my information and you asked me to be on the podcast, I was like, I have a foul mouth. So
that's okay.
I was like, oh my God, I hope I don't say anything to piss anybody off. But, between insurance and the medical field, it's a lost cause. Politics got their hands in everything, and your hands are basically tied when it comes to your loved ones. It's, and I've been doing a lot of research. I went back to school, for social work so I can, figure out how am I going to help my son be successful in this world. I'm sure that's every mother's,
So
all we want is success for our family.
Okay, so I mean, when did you notice a change? Like, was it a progressive change or
no?
Like overnight, it was like roar, you know.
It was overnight.
Oh wow!
It was like a turning on the light switch. But the crazy thing is that we noticed something was wrong, but we kind of just, you know, we kind of like, we, you know, like, oh, he's just got an attitude. Oh, he's just, you know, oh, he's just having a rough week. Oh, he's just being an asshole. Maybe he's drinking, maybe he's doing drugs or, which in a lot of cases when someone is struggling with mental illness, I mean, that's the first thing they do start doing is they start doing drugs and they start drinking. So, but that wasn't the case at this point with us.
I mean, so what was there, did they ever discover a cause for this change or was it just, you know, was it environmentally caused or was it all internal?
During the beginnings of it, so maybe the first 3 years was pure hell. Literally, you really don't know. They don't know. Your brain is so complex. So, you know, then we start doing research, we start doing our own homework, and next thing you know, when I start realizing, you know, this is genetic. You know, and a lot of people will say, no, it's not genetic. You can change your food. You can change. No, no, you can't. I've done the timeline through our family, through his dad's family. And I mean, it runs. It runs a long way through my family. So my dad's side of the family. So it's genetic. And after, I think, so he's been in the hospital, but I guess going on 10 times. This was his 10th time. I think maybe about the 7th time, one of the doctors finally had a talk with us. He was like, was he just like a regular, normal kid? And, you know, and then next thing you know, it just, and I was like, yeah. He was like, yeah, that's the way it happens. And I wish someone would have told us that, you know. But, you know, you go to the doctor, they band-aid you and they send you home.
Right. So. I mean, what, like, how many opinions you had to get before you even got to that, that close to a diagnosis?
Well, he had to, he had tried committing suicide twice. The hallucinations were unreal. There was a point, I can't honestly, I think maybe like the sixth or seventh time that he was in the hospital is when I think the shock that comes over your family year and all the struggles and all the bad things that are happening, you're just kind of like, why is this happening? And you just kind of get through it. But I think finally at that maybe sixth or seventh time, we were like, hold on. No, we need some information. People need to start talking to us, you know, because you go to the doctor and they tell you what, you know, what they want to tell you. And you're like, okay. And you go home.
Almost so, like that scene from Idiocracy where he went to the doctor. He's like, here, shove this in your mouth and shove this up the other end. And we'll just diagnose you that way.
Exactly. This is what's best for you. Here, you go. You take it.
Here.
No, bullshit. Everybody's different. Everybody's brain is different. Everybody behaves different. And finally, we sat down, and my husband was like, "No, you're gonna sit here until we understand what everybody's future in our family is gonna be like, because it affects your entire family."
Yes, of course.
So
I mean, you know, it's like, can he be around children? I mean, can he be around other adults? Is he a danger to himself or others? Well, I mean, you know, we already got,
and
those questions.
When people think of mental illness, what's the first thing that comes to their mind? You see it on the media. All you see is a bunch of crazy fucks, right?
Well, yeah. I mean, I live in New York City. I mean, the mental illness I see are usually the homeless guy, you know, you know, either rapping a song about whatever or having a discuss. Like, there was this one guy, he used to walk around with a stuffed duck and he would have a conversation with it. I mean, it's, you know, you either get that or you get the ones that will bash you in the head with a brick. I mean, that's
aggressive. Yeah. And the sad thing is that nobody cares.
Yeah.
I fight tooth and nail. When we go to the doctor or when mm-hmm. my son has to go into the hospital, mm-hmm. it's not because he's aggressive and crazy. It's because it scares him internally and it worries him. And so he feels safer there. So he'll go for a couple of days and then he comes home and he's fine. You know, if you watch the podcast, it tells you his whole story. He's naturally an introvert.
Right.
So for him, so when all this started, it was like, okay, you know, he's already to himself. So he's quiet, he's peaceful, he's happy.
Mm-hmm.
He's very kind. I mean, God forbid you kill a bee in our house. No, he will trap it and he will send it on its way. But that's because he takes his medication and that's because his family surrounds him. And I mean, I don't take anything less than what is out there. And honestly, there's not a lot, mm-hmm. to be totally honest. You have to fight tooth and nail to get help for your family, for someone that has an illness these days, because otherwise you're going to see them walking down the street with a duck. And I don't want that for my son, you know? Needs to change. I mean,
yeah.
It's everywhere. It doesn't discriminate. Mental illness does not discriminate. Rich, poor, black, white, Mexican, Latino, Filipino, I don't care. It's in every family.
Yeah.
And, you know, they're not doing anything about it.
So, I mean, basically, what, like, how did the doctors try to dismiss you? Like, what did they say to just, like, you know, downplay your son's illness?
Okay.
Like,
so,
what should people look for to be like, no, stupid, you're doing your job? Like, what were the words they said? So that way people outside could be like, no, you're trying to, you're giving me the blow off now.
So when someone has a total breakdown, you take them to a mental facility, mm-hmm. an asylum, or they don't call them asylums anymore. They call them mental health, mental behavior facilities. That's what they call them now. Mm-hmm. So you don't have much contact. You put them in the hospital and they assess them because it's your brain. It's really hard to determine exactly what's going on. So they assess within a 14-day period, right? They give them some medications and they discharge them and send you home with them. And that's it. And you're like, okay, so now what do? You get a discharge that says, take your medicines at these times, this time, this time. If you feel this way, come back, give us a call. I took it upon myself to find a we have a psychiatrist. We have a regular therapist that he sees the regular doctor. He has music therapy. This guy comes over and they play the guitar together. Mm-hmm. They play for hours. And then he has he goes to horse therapy. The idea is to be consistent, but they don't tell you anything, nothing. They just send you home and they expect families to be like, okay, I got this. And then you just paid them $14,000 for 7 days or 14 days, you know?
Goodness.
Yeah. It was $28,000 for 7 days one time.
And insurance doesn't cover that?
Yeah, insurance pays for it. I mean, we have really good insurance, which I'm thankful for.
Okay.
Don't even get me on social medicine because I'm not, oh my gosh.
Yeah.
I mean, we have really good insurance and we pay out of our ass for it. But most doctors, all they want to do is prescribe medication because that's where the money is in medication management. That's where the money's at with this.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, not to sound like a conspiracy theorist, but, you know,
But yeah. If you want to talk about Big Pharma, that's a whole nother story.
Well, yeah.
I've learned the hard way. Mm-hmm. I mean, because I've always been a pushover, and for some reason, all of a sudden, it just came over me that I better take charge. You know?
Yeah. Well, and the mama lioness just came out.
I know he needs his medication, absolutely. But there's so much more that everybody else needs than just medication, because they're not going to take it.
Right.
You know, that's why they're homeless. That's why they're out on the street. And that's why there's anger and you know, everybody's so damn aggressive. And there's so much ugliness because nobody handles their business emotionally. You know, you're not a tough guy if you handle your emotions, or right. You better, because then you see shit on TV, you know, bad stuff, you know. And that's all I ever hear. Mm-hmm. You know, well, he was dealing with it mentally, but yet no one addresses it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I mean, it is well known that we do have a mental health issue in America, but they blame it on other things. Like when they act out or cause violence, they blame it on something else. They don't blame it on there's no prevention. Like you said in that podcast, there's no prevention for mental illness. They'll lock down the whole society if someone has the sniffles. but if someone starts hearing voices and I mean, I'm being facetious right now, but you know, if you believe your dog is talking to you and telling you to kill your family, that, you know, everyone just says, oh, he's just eccentric.
Oh, he's just expressing himself.
Yeah.
No, I mean, everybody wants to blow it off. Everybody wants to blame something else. But in actuality, it starts in elementary school. You know, I mean, that's where it really starts. You know, you got to start watching your family and watching your kids and pay attention to them, and don't just medicate them. You know, you got to interact with, you know, you got to have that family connection. Mm-hmm. I think that's the only thing. And if you don't have family, then I mean, there's other, and that's just the problem. There's not organizations. I've been searching for something for his age to where that, because he is social within the family, but you know, he's always been such an introvert, and I think that he needs to have peers. Yeah. You know, but unless he's an alcoholic or a drug addict, which to me, there's an underlining issue if you're drug addict and alcoholic.
Yeah, of course. Self-medication.
There's no prevention. There's nothing for me to put him in to be like, hey, go to groups. Here's a group for you for your age, just because you're depressed. Mm-hmm. And you know, no, I love Texas. My God, by all means, I love Texas. I'm Texas through and through. Mm-hmm. But I'm gonna have to move somewhere else in order to Minneapolis
to get
my son what he needs. You know. And I will, but I shouldn't have to.
Yeah, nobody, I mean, should. Be careful in Minneapolis. I mean, especially nowadays.
No. No, you're right.
Yeah, they probably burnt that doctor's place to the ground already.
Oh, Jesus, because you know what? There's like the perfect example of a place for men of all ages to get any type of mental health help, not just medication. I didn't even think about that. Oh my gosh. I just like, I talked to him like a couple months ago. I should probably call and check on him. Anyway.
Right. All right. But I mean, has your son ever faced any stigma that perhaps like made his condition worse, or like caused an episode?
Exaggerated it?
Yeah.
Exacerbated?
There you go. Now I said it.
No, because I think in the beginning that some people were a little standoffish, but I don't think maybe he even recognized it because of the way I am. Then I kind of make everyone like, hey, he's just as normal as us. He's just like extremely a little more sensitive to sound. He's a little more sensitive to light, so he wears his sunglasses, you know. He's really shy, and that's basically about it, you know. Other than that, I do notice that people will stare because he like will stand really close to me, or or maybe that's just me. I feel that way because I'm worried that somebody will what's the word,
mess with him.
Yeah, you know, they'll be like, oh my god, what a weirdo, or they'll try to videotape, or I mean, he doesn't do anything odd, like out of the norm. He's just, you know, he won't look at you in the eyes, he looks down, you know, and people, when they'll notice stuff like that, you know, or when he talks to you, he won't look at you in your eyes because he's worried that you don't like him, you know. And sometimes the scariest thing is anybody with a mental illness, 90% of the time, they're more afraid of you than they are, than you should be of them. That I've come across, you know.
Well, I mean, so my question is, I mean, God forbid, you're not going to live forever. I mean, may you live to 120. but what's going to happen to him? I mean, he's going to have to learn how to manage himself.
And that's what terrifies me. You know, I can drive down the road and like you said, you know, you see the guys walking down the street, you know, we volunteer at our local homeless shelter. It's a day facility called the Hangar. And we go down there and, you know, and they're so nice to Charlie. They're like, hey, Charlie. And, you know, sometimes he doesn't talk at all. He'll go like a whole month without talking. Wow. You know, and but he'll lift his head and he says, hi. I just want him to be aware. I'm trying to educate him on, like, you've got to stay on your medicine. You've got it, you know, you've got to interact. You know, you don't have a choice. But I think that these are skills that they need to relearn.
Yeah.
When they're struggling through all this, you know.
And there's absolutely no help that, like, no group or any doctor he could go to, like, help. Speak to someone to help learn these skills, like a trained professional?
No, nothing. I searched high and low, and the one place I found was in Minneapolis. It's called Face It or something like that, and it's for men, you know, and I think men, and it does, it hits men harder than it hits women. It hits men between the ages of 18 and 25. And I can't find anything for his age. I know, Minneapolis, of all places.
That's really, that's,
yeah,
really,
I've searched sad. I mean, I've searched in every county in Texas. There's nothing.
Have you spoken to any, like, politicians to see, hey, have you thought about becoming an activist for this? Because, I mean, it is needed. It can prevent like a ton of actual school shootings and or whatever other types of violence.
You know, I talked to NAMI. It's an organization for mental illness, and I've talked to local, and then I've talked to state, and. You know, I don't even understand how, now I'm going to get on another soapbox. All
Go
the
ahead.
Fundraising for mental illness. I watch people have concerts. I've seen huge celebrities raise money, millions of dollars. And I'm just like, where the hell is all this money going? Because, I mean, I'm searching. You have no idea the help that people need that they don't get, and I'm confused as to where does all that money go, because when I called NAMI, I was really concerned about if something happened to me financially, how was Charlie going to take care of himself? Yeah. So I called them. So it's National Association for Mental Illness. Sorry. I called them and I said I needed a lawyer that kind of specializes with someone with mental illness. This is a huge organization. She told me that, oh, just Google it and you should find somebody local.
Oh, my God.
Wasn't the whole point for me to call and have someone help me? And
she did. She told you exactly where to go and how to do it. Google it.
She told me to Google it. Yeah.
For that, she probably earned $100,000 that year.
Google it. Yeah, and she has a fundraiser every year. And I was like, yeah, you're not getting my check, sister.
Mm-hmm.
No way. No, I know everybody has a different view on it. I'm just a mom.
Yeah.
You know, trying to figure out how I'm going to help my son survive this. And it scares me. I just want him to be successful. I guess one of my biggest things that I'd like to advocate for is that I want all the hospital staff,
mm-hmm.
The specific area for mental illness. I think all hospital staff and all law enforcement, and like even if you work in the reception area of law enforcement, because they only get 8 hours of training to work with someone with mental illness.
Wow.
8 hours. Yeah, that's all they're required to have. It's not mandated that they actually.
I mean, and God forbid he's having an attack, for lack of a better term, and he's around a police officer that is not trained, because I've seen videos like that. I mean, you know, there was this young boy who had autism. He was autistic, and he didn't know how to respond to the officer, and the officer just slammed him on the ground because he didn't know anybody.
Just as vital as any other illness, but for some reason, this is the one that's sitting on the back burner, but it's the one that is most prevalent right now in going on. I mean, there was a shooting at some church, and it was some guy went in the church and shot. And the first thing that they said was, well, he had been dealing with some mental issues. And and I'm like, every time I turn, I can't even watch TV anymore. I'm like, do something. And, you know, when you go to school for social work, they teach you all of this, all the laws, and I mean, you learn all this stuff, and I'm like, so this stuff is taught every year, but nothing has changed.
Yeah, well, but, because, I mean, look, I've worked around social workers. All they are is glorified form filler uppers. That's it. They don't help nobody. They would rather just sit on their can, fill out a form for you, wish you good luck, and make it somebody else's problem. That's what a social worker is.
Okay, well, she's the one that told. So when I wanted him to do a group, I was like, we want to do preventative so that he doesn't do drugs and he doesn't want to do alcohol, you know, because when you're struggling with mental illness, the self-medicating is the first thing you do. And I was like, is there anything preventative, like a group, you know, something to keep them interacting with others? And she's like, yeah, we'll let him come down and I'll assess him. And I'm like, you're a social worker. How are you going to assess him? I mean, I know all the classes that you guys took. I didn't take anything to assess anybody. You know, I could probably pinpoint it, but yeah, it's nuts. It's a bunch of bullshit. I don't know where all the money is.
Language!
I'm sure we do know, but...
Yeah. You know. Oh, my goodness. I'm really sorry. Like, how can like, someone like me or, like, my audience help you? Help, like, make this better? Because there has to be a solution. I mean, I don't believe that, you know, everything is, like, you know, come, you know...
I think this part of society is. I seriously believe that. I mean, mental illness, the laws are from the 70s. And then prior to that, I don't think they had been touched since maybe CPS was formed. It's crazy. The 70s, and then prior to that, I can't even remember when it was touched. But the law changed that children cannot be with senior citizens and older adults in asylums. So that was like way before the 70s. But that was it. That was one of the laws that changed. That was it. Yeah. No. I really honestly, other than just constantly speaking out, and that if you do know somebody or families, because families are still embarrassed. Mm-hmm. They don't want to talk about it and they don't want help. I mean, my family's living proof of that. Yeah. My extended family, like my mom and my uncles and my aunts, and no, they don't want to talk about it, you know?
Yeah. I kind of make a joke about this, but like, I didn't know I was going to have you on, but I've actually made a joke, but it's based on reality. Like in Latin culture, what we do with our mentally ill, we just like throw them in the backyard, like free range chicken. And you forget it.
Hey, as long as you're fed.
Yeah.
And you got clothes and you got a roof over your head, everything's fine.
Yeah. I mean, but it's like really the saddest thing I've ever seen. But it's like there you're right. There's absolutely no help for people like that. Like, I mean, hey, if you got erectile dysfunction, oh, my goodness, there's tons of clinics and whatnot for you. But, you know, you're trying not to like speak to the devil in your brain and there's like nothing. Like, here's a pill that's probably going to turn your brain into Swiss cheese and make you have suicidal thoughts. I mean, you see these pills marketed on TV. It's like, if you have suicidal, this may cause suicidal thoughts or making you think you're a Slimer from the Ghostbusters. Like, wait, what?
It's going to make you even worse.
Yeah, it's
go
like,
ahead, take it.
What's the fucking point?
You're going to start collecting thumbs, but it's okay. You'll feel better. Yeah, no, you won't.
No.
You'll be in prison with everybody else.
Yeah, how is this approved by the FDA?
I swear to God, you want to talk about conspiracies. Yeah, it's big pharma and prison systems. Texas is one of the largest. We have the largest population of prisoners.
Mm-hmm.
And we have the most privately funded prisons. Private. So you want as many people in there as possible.
Of course.
Well, and most of them are all minorities or ethnic, not Caucasian. And most of them are getting funneled all kind of medication, tons of psychotic medications, tons of them. Hmm. How do I know this? Because I have tons of, not tons. I mean, I am Mexican, so I got a big family. But okay. I have a lot of family.
O de lepue.
I don't, everybody's listening that's in New York, right? But I got a lot of family.
Not everyone. I got people all over. I got the people from
Germany. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
You know, that are in prison. And, you know, and I've sat down and we've talked about it. And, you know, and we've talked about the history and why were you there? What was it like in there? What goes on in there? And then the mental illness thing just, you know, it scares me. You know, because that's the line that you go down. You go down with, you're either homeless, you commit suicide, or you're in prison.
It's almost like, you know, it's preferable to commit suicide because then you're no longer no one else's problem. I mean, it just really seems like, from what you're telling me, it just seems like everyone just passes the buck. It's like, okay, it's not my problem. Here, have some pills. It's not my problem anymore. Here, go to this person. It's not my problem anymore.
Go to this hospital.
Go to that hospital.
That hospital. And the hospitals
are
babysitters. And I've had doctors or psychiatrists tell me all they did was babysit. And I'm like, yes, all they did was babysit. And when I picked him up, he was high as a kite. He couldn't even walk. He was so over-medicated. Mm. All they did was medication management, which is not what was needed, and babysat. They're babysitters, and they pass the buck. They pass the buck. That's exactly right.
How is anyone supposed to heal?
There's no healing. Do you see the circle that I...
Yeah.
Do you see I talk in circles?
Yes.
Because that's how I'm... That's how we're treated constantly. It's like, so what do I do today? Like, what, like, if, okay, say he goes through a depression state.
Yeah.
You know, what do most people do? They stay in bed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't want him. I don't want that for him. I want, you know, so I go in circles. Who am I going to talk to? Who am I going to ask? You know, they don't check on you later. You just go for your appointments. You know, you go for your appointments. No one gives a crap. It's nuts. Austin is just obscene. I mean, you should, right down the street from the mental hospitals. I mean, it's Tent City. It's crazy. It's nuts.
So, I mean, like, are you going to go to Minneapolis? I mean, if that's...
I considered it, but then all this started.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, it's... I mean, because... I can't like, what's the... That's not sustainable. The way you're living, no. The way he's living, it's not... It can't be sustainable. I mean, what... he has to be able to, like, someday... Like, God forbid, I mean...
Yeah.
I mean, what's, and what luckily, about what about getting married and having kids and all that? I mean, I hate to sound like I'm twisting the knife here.
No.
But...
This is not anything that I've never even... I mean, that's probably my biggest fears. What the hell is going to happen?
Yeah, I mean...
What the hell is going to happen to my son that I have given absolutely everything?
Yeah.
I'm a goddamn taxpayer. I mean, they basically suck the life out of us. And then they expect me to come to them for help. And there's no damn help. Nothing.
I mean, the only...
Absolutely, I mean, nothing.
Like, God forbid... Like, if he was to have an episode and something like...
Mm-hmm.
A police officer doesn't know what's going on, and you know, he gets jumpy, bang bang.
Yeah.
And like, well, then what? Like, oh well.
Yeah.
He's like,
I feel sorry for that place. I feel sorry for everybody involved in that. And it, I mean, it's so important that they get trained.
Yeah.
You know, it scares the shit out of me. Mm-hmm. He goes so. You know, mycology is the study of mushrooms.
Yeah.
Okay, so way back when hospitals were able to, you know, actually help people before Big Pharma, so they were given psychedelics to patients with schizophrenia.
Right.
There's actually a facility in California that does it.
Mm-hmm.
And I've looked into it anyway. And so he has started studying... mushrooms. So he'll go to the park down the road. I'm not kidding. The anxiety that I get when he leaves the house. I mean, he's 23. He can do whatever he wants to do.
Right.
But the anxiety, you know, what if all of a sudden somebody startles the shit out of him and he freaks out and goes and huddles in a corner, you know, and some crazy cop comes over, or somebody, not just a cop, just anybody,
mm-hmm.
you know, and they don't know what's wrong with him and they harass him, you know? It scares the shit out of me.
Yeah.
I don't want to single out the cops, but that's my biggest fear.
Mm-hmm.
You know? It's common.
I mean, unfortunately, it's common. I mean,
extremely common.
They try to make it a race issue, but I think it's just a bad training, police bad training issue, or lack of training.
It's a lack of training. Yeah. I mean,
I mean, you know, it's... So the main problem is no prevention mm-hmm. treatment, no real treatment. Just here's some drugs. Hopefully it doesn't, like, you know, turn your brain into Swiss cheese.
Yeah, insurance pays for one type of therapy, and then they'll pay for you to be in the hospital for, you know, for about 14 days.
Hmm.
You know, which is fine. Because I don't want him in a hospital. He needs to be home with his family. You know,
right.
He's functionable. But the fact of, you know, the fact that he loud noises and you know, and him not taking off his sunglasses somewhere. Somebody might, you know, like you go in a bank, you have to take your sunglasses and your hat off or something like that.
Yeah.
You know, and what if he walks in and you know, the lack of education is just obscene for for everybody, even families. Mm-hmm. I've even gotten after family members for saying stupid shit like, why won't Charlie cut his hair? He looks like, you know, he looked like Albert Einstein. I don't remember what they said. It was at Thanksgiving. Mm. And of course, there's no joke about me being overreacting. I'm extremely sensitive when it comes to them, to my kids, right. You know, my son. I don't want anybody. What if it hurt his feelings? Maybe he thought it was funny, but what if it did hurt his feelings? Yeah. You know, don't be stupid. Watch what you say, you know, watch your mouth. The lack of education, it's in a hole. It's with everybody. Absolutely freaking everybody.
Hmm.
Yeah. It's not a medication issue.
So, I mean, I know I probably already asked this, but what's the plan? What's the plan? Like, what's the long-term plan? I mean, there has to be, is there any light at the end of the tunnel so far?
So this has been a 5-year process, and I know people that have been struggling with it. I've made friends, that their kids are like in their 30s and stuff. And, I think I'm handling things a little different.
Mm-hmm.
I'm preparing for that long term, you know, I'm optimistic, but I think I might be too optimistic and I'm okay with that.
I see.
Will he always need to live with somebody? Probably. If not, more than likely he'd become like a hoarder or a hermit or something, I think. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Shit.
I mean, is he well enough to work?
Yeah, he could probably have a part-time job, but I'm still on the edge of, I don't want anybody to be ugly. People are so freaking ugly and mean.
Yep.
I just, you know, we are so grateful and blessed that we have, you know, our company does really well. So, you know, every now and then, you know, he'll come to work with me or my husband will take him to work with him. And if we have a job, he'll do a little bit on the job. And, you know, he works at home. He wants to do, you know, I don't have to hire a housekeeper. He didn't clean thoroughly. He's a guy, for God's sakes. But he does like his own chores and stuff and his own laundry and the dishes. And so, I mean, he's pretty active, but him working out in the real world, no. Yeah. I can't even see it happening right now.
So, I want to go a little deep. I don't know how to phrase this because I don't want to.
You won't hurt my feelings.
Yeah.
I think what happened was is that when I started talking about it openly, some people were highly offended in my family. And I think that kind of toughened me up for anything that anybody has to say because they weren't walking on eggshells.
So what's the, like, what's it like internally in his head, if you know? Like, what type of, like, the hell that's going on in him? Is he, like, locked in his mind a lot?
Yeah. Yeah. He plays his music a lot. Because he says it's easier for him to channel. But if he's having psychosis, everybody's psychosis is different.
Right.
I've read tons of books and everyone has different psychosis. He thinks that during a psychosis, he thinks that people think that he's ugly. And that dogs will purposely bark at him and that birds purposely chirp at him, like on purpose. Like, you know, me and you could probably walk down the street and be like, oh, that's a nice bird.
Yeah.
His is like, oh my gosh, why is the, he won't verbally say it, but you know, it would, you can tell his face gets red and he looks like he wants to, like his eyes will get watery and, you know, he'll be ready to leave if we go anywhere, you know? And, so it's pretty tough, you know, I can't even imagine, it breaks my heart, literally, you know, when I try to sit down and talk to him, because all I'm doing is talking and he just kind of waves me away. He doesn't want to talk about it. A lot of a lot of people's success with this, with their mental illness, is accepting it. Mm-hmm. I own it. I accept it. This is what's wrong with me. And, you know, and I'm going to move on from it. But I think at his age and, you know, we really thought, I mean, I was the mom that had the life planned out.
Yeah.
Everything was planned out. This is the school you're going to go to. This is a private school, elementary, private, high school, college. This is what's going to happen, you know, church, blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
And no, shit did not pan out the way I planned it. And it didn't plan out the way he planned it. And I don't think, and he still says, you know, I'm fine. Nothing's wrong with me. I'm fine. Nothing's wrong with me.
So how are you and your husband coping with this? Because I'm pretty sure it's like a big, it's a big burden.
We're not divorced.
Okay.
And I haven't killed him. He hasn't killed me.
Oh, okay.
It was hard in the first three and a half years. I think over the year and a half, we finally have joined together and united, but it was bad.
Mm-hmm.
It was bad because he's a man. He was like, nothing's wrong with him. You know, what the hell's wrong with him? He needs to get his abs up. He needs to get a job. He did have a job. And when he was working, I mean, he was working his ass off.
Mm-hmm.
And he was saving his money. He was frugal. He was, you know, he bought what he wanted. He was never late to work. And then all of a sudden, it was like, you know, we know that you're on drugs. And we know that it was a struggle because I was like, you know, stop treating him like that. You know, something's wrong. But nobody, you know.
Yeah, they didn't want to deal with it. They didn't know how to explain it. So it was easier to try to chase him away.
I think men, when they see their son, I'm only speaking from like experiences that I've like literally witnessed or like talked to people. I mean, I'm not a freaking doctor or anything, but I think, and anything that I've read, it's like men don't want to see that. It feels like they failed their family, their son,
yeah,
or their daughter, you know, and it's harder for them to accept it. And there's a lot of guilt,
mm-hmm,
when there shouldn't be any damn guilt. I mean, there was nothing we could do about it. There is nothing, absolutely nothing. And I don't give a shit what anybody says. There was nothing. This was inevitable.
Mm-hmm.
If it was going to happen, it was going to happen. You know, I have it in my family, and I have, you know, I have family members. I mean, do your homework, know your family, your family's history. You'll find it. If it's there, I mean, it's genetic. It's a lot genetic. It's a lot genetic. You know?
So, I mean, okay, let's go into how other people reacted. How many stupid, Google search homeopathic remedies did you get from friends or family?
That's hilarious. No, for real. The ashwagandha, what is that?
Ayahuasca.
I was going to do it, but there's no way on earth I was going to take him to do it. I'm like, he's already hallucinating. Why do I need him to hallucinate more?
Yeah.
I mean,
and honestly, from what I hear, you... you know, you see demons and stuff, and it's not very good because you open your mind up to something else, and it might end up worse.
It could have, like, because I mean, this is, these are brain issues. These are, you know, brain issues. This is a chemical, this is a dopamine issue, you know, that us, what is it?
Ayahuasca.
Ayahuasca. I always say it wrong. Ayahuasca.
Didn't your people invent that though?
I have friends that do it, and I'm like, I'm not going, and I'm not taking him. You're like out of your damn mind.
I mean, you know, our people have pasteles. Like,
this fool is already tripping.
We got pasteles and we got penil. That's how we get down. You guys got ayahuasca and freaking peace pipes and shit like that.
Patchouli.
Like, yeah, we're like looking at you like, damn, I mean, life is not enough. Like, Jesus.
Add an extra. Like, add an extra dose of
how that. How fucked up do you guys need to be?
I mean, for real. You know, let them smoke pot. I don't have a problem with pot, to each his own.
Right.
But like I said, everybody's brain is different. Mm-hmm. Everybody reacts to anything different. Even freaking food you eat, we react different. I tried it with him because I thought I wanted to do anything as holistic as possible, because with a mental illness, you start developing a lot more physical, like diabetes and what was the other one? I'm not heart condition, but
high blood pressure,
because you don't take care of yourself.
Right.
So I wanted to do as much holistic as possible. Yeah. Well, that, it made it worse. He was like paranoid. And I was like, oh my gosh, I'm like a really bad mom. I'm like, what did I do? I didn't give him a lot. I gave him a little bit of oil, and I was hoping that maybe it would relax him. Mm-hmm. And that it would, you know, kind of, I don't know, help him talk and feel more relaxed talking. Because, you know, I've seen other people high and they're fine. They're, you know, just talking and laughing and whatever. And, but, you know, what else stupid thing did some...
we got ayahuasca, weed.
Ayahuasca, weed. Oh, the oils, aromatherapy. I tried the aromatherapy with the light and the little vase thing, and it changes colors. Mm-hmm. He wrote me a note. He said, please get this out of my room.
Yeah.
I'm like, okay. I was like, what was I thinking, you know? I was like, hello. what else? But the aromatherapy is not bad. I mean, seriously, I think that helps, you know, with what is it, the transmitter, what is it in your brain?
Neurotransmitters.
Yeah, yeah.
Neural uptake inhibitor. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Yeah. what else?
I'm not a smart man. I don't know nothing about craniacs or whatever. I don't know.
You knew neurotransmitters?
I kind of figured there's a neuron and some transmitters and
did
maybe
you
some,
Google that?
Yeah. Neural transmitters and receivers. Where, you know, they're 5G.
The 5G.
The 5G. That's. Have you, did somebody say, it's the 5G that's making your son sick?
You have no idea.
Oh, God.
Yes. Because he's always wearing headphones.
Okay.
I mean, he's always listening to music. Yeah. And, you know, and it's crazy because a lot of people with mental illnesses, I don't know if you do the research, it's nuts. A lot of them go into music.
Yeah.
A lot of them listen to loud music. It tunnels that, the noise in their head. Mm-hmm. You know, there's headphones, there's some simulated headphones out there that you can put on, and it tells you, and it and you can hear how someone with schizophrenia, it, when they have an episode, like, that's what it sounds like.
Wow.
Yeah, I haven't gotten my hands on them. I probably should, my next venture. I spend too much money.
That sounds like hell.
It's become our lifestyle. Yeah. You know, I think, you know, I talk about all the therapies and stuff. Insurance doesn't pay for that. Mm. And most psychiatrists don't even take insurance anymore. They don't want to deal with them. Mm-hmm. 'Cause they want to limit you on, you know, on what they can do and how they can treat and stuff, which is stupid, beyond stupid. But the sad thing is that a lot of the issues going on that you see everywhere, all the freaking chaos, all the anger, all the violence, it roots from somewhere.
Yeah.
It's rooted from somewhere. And if someone had trauma, you develop mental illnesses from trauma, you know? Mm-hmm. People think when they hear the words mental illness that it's just like batshit crazy.
Yeah.
No. You know, there's trauma in that.
But if you're going to go crazy, you might as well go batshit and crazy. You don't want to
might as well go for the gold.
Yeah, exactly. You don't want to be regular crazy because regular crazy, you know, they're just like, come on, dude. Really? Just friggin' hang in there.
Just hang
in there. It's like batshit. Then you get people like, oh, wow, maybe you do have problems. Maybe we should get you some help if you need it.
Okay, so we've accepted it as our family and, yeah. And we can make jokes. Like, you know, we have like this little dark humor. We have a 12-year-old daughter,
mm-hmm.
and then we have a 21-year-old, and we're all really close. And I mean, my dad, you know, he's got a huge family support, which he's, you know,
good.
Not many do. And so he, you know, we're so grateful and lucky that we have everybody, but we do have some serious dark ass humor. Like one time he was picking up cigarette butts and I was like, what the hell are you doing? He's like, I want to smoke a cigarette. I was like, why are you freaking picking up other people's cigarette butts? And my husband was like, hey, at least he ain't collecting thumbs, okay? I'm like, fine. Yeah. At least he's not collecting people's fingers. So
yeah. I mean, he's going green.
Yeah, he's going gray. He was picking up the litter.
Yeah,
he was helping. But little I have these things in my mouth. I can't talk.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the movie Idiocracy.
Idiocracy, yes.
Yes. So he has little bitty things that he does, but it's nothing like, it's nothing because he takes his medication. Mm-hmm. And if people took their medication and, you know, and people loved them and they had connection, human connection, you know, you wouldn't see all that. The guy with the duck, you know, that's somebody's son, you know, that makes me so sick and, you know, it pisses me off.
Yeah. I mean, when you think of schizophrenia, I mean, I remember growing up, you know, there was this Polish guy in the park. He was just screaming and yelling at himself, you know, and people just stayed away because he was like, you know, he'd be screaming in Polish. Goodness. This Klingon is angry at something.
Like Star Wars. Is it Star? No.
Oh, my God.
What is that? Star Trek?
Oh, no. Oh, no. Okay. You just started the war. The Like a Witch.
Oh, my God. Do you watch anime?
Yes, I do. Yes, I do.
No!
Yes, I do.
I got a therapist for you.
Hey, look. A lot of those animes have very good storylines, and I'm not obsessed. It's not like I walk around with a Naruto headband and run like an idiot. It's more like, this is very artistic. Yes. Miyazaki. Yes. This is very highbrow.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, for real. I tried watching.
And yes, I do get upset when Netflix does a live action version of it. And I'm like, ha! It's like they didn't even watch the source material.
I think people are scared of the word schizophrenia in general.
Yeah. I mean,
it looks like a scary word.
Yeah.
And it's associated with a lot of scary shit.
It really is because when you see someone with schizophrenia, you think someone, well, you think of that movie Sybil. You think of that, I'm really way too young to even know that movie, but, you know.
It's a very popular movie, but she didn't have schizophrenia. She had split personality disorder.
And that's what there you go. That's what people mm-hmm. think schizophrenia is having multiple personalities, and
people think that schizophrenia is everything.
Yeah,
like the one word is everything.
Yeah.
Do you know the hardest mental illness to live with is bipolar?
Mm.
Because one minute you're functional, and then the next minute it is just like, so I mean, you're like living a great 4 months, just smooth as could be. And then all of a sudden, I mean, just shit hits the fan.
Hmm.
So, I mean, it's a whirlwind. I mean, I have friends that have sons and daughters that have, you know, that I've met, you know, through all this. And then I just started doing the research and I'm like, this is not, I mean, schizophrenia is, you can function on schizophrenia if you take your medicine properly and you have the right dosage and you do the right therapies. I mean, there's doctors and lawyers that I've read books on that, you know, that just live really good lives.
Right.
You know, but they've accepted it. They've accepted it. It happened so young and his life was going into a certain direction because he was heading off to college when all this started.
Mm.
So then that depression kicked in, and that's what we've been struggling with is the depression, not the I'm crazy and, you know, I want to kill people. My brain is telling me, you know, to kill people and shit. No, it's the depression that is literally, you know, holding him back because he's so miserable that this has happened to him. It's crazy.
Yeah.
So the stigma with the word schizophrenia, I haven't even watched that movie with
Sally Field, I think.
No.
No.
No, with the one that won some awards just recently, and the guy said that he was not going to wear his tuxedo twice, or he was going to wear it, he was going to recycle it, not buy another one to save money. What was his name? His brother was River Phoenix.
Joaquin, yeah.
What was the movie?
Joker.
The Joker. Yeah. I refused to watch it. I couldn't even watch, what was that, Glass?
Oh,
with
yeah.
With a guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can't watch any of that.
I don't know. Joker was a pretty good movie. I was, like, really impressed with it.
Really?
Yeah. But, but I could see why you would want to stay away from it.
Yeah. The reality is just obscene.
Oh, it is. It is because you end. It makes you feel bad for the Joker, because yeah. I mean he was trying. He was taking his medications, and then all of a sudden they shut it down, and he has to. He's by himself. He's like you know.
And they're supposed to have social workers that go check on them.
Yeah.
Weekly, monthly. And you know, I know people that I've spoken to people and they're like, no, he hadn't this. I'm like, so has your social worker came and they can help you? And they're like, no, we haven't seen him in months.
Oh my goodness.
I'm like, you gotta be shitting me.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, because this person is out there literally just wandering the streets, you know, because they get checks, right? So mm-hmm. You can file for disability.
Yeah.
But you have to be compliant to continue to get your check. You know, just because they have some sort of mental illness, don't assume that they're all stupid. You know, because, I mean, I've witnessed a lot of them. I'm like, you're sitting there literally trying to compromise with a doctor.
Yeah.
So, you know, they know what they're doing sometimes, you know, unless they're having an episode, then I'll go for that. But I don't know. Anyway, yeah. It just throws me for a whirlwind.
Hmm.
I go on a tangent. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, that's fine. I mean, it helps. I mean, like, okay, so like someone like me, what do you want someone like me to understand about your son's illness? Like to like destigmatize him.
Just to be kind to everybody. I think the only thing that's going to help this is to be kind to those, you know, we've learned that down there at the homeless shelter. Mm-hmm. Because some of those guys, they struggle with it.
Yeah.
But just them coming in and you helping them and and being kind to them, they want to take their medicine. They actually have that feeling of want, because I'm assuming when you are down to the worst of your worst, you don't have that feeling of want or desire, you know? And I think we've all lost that be kind kind of thing, you know? Humans are so not nice. They're just shit asses. They're just assholes to each other, you know?
Shit asses.
I don't know. They're just freaking, they're assholes.
It's just in combination.
Hey, don't take it, okay? I'm gonna copyright it. My shit ass word.
Goddamn shit ass is running.
You're a
here.
Shit ass. Hey, just for my, because I'm from Texas, I don't sound like that.
I don't want my daughter dating no goddamn shit ass.
Shit ass. You're a shit ass.
These days, I wish they would go back to their shit ass.
Aren't you Puerto Rican? Say it in Puerto Rican.
Yeah.
You damn shit ass. Yeah, I am. Anyway, no, honestly. All I really want is just, you know, when someone is having an episode or someone is standing out there in the road, you know, screaming, they need help. They don't need you to fucking videotape them and humiliate them. They don't need you to freaking call the cops and say that you're terrified or whatever. You know, say, hey, you know, that guy, you know, that guy needs help, you know? That's someone's son. That's someone's, you know, brother. And, you know, treat him like a damn human being, you know?
But it's easier to just disregard them and...
Oh, God, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, look, I'm guilty of doing that. It's like, you're powerless to help. So it's like... just direct your eyes down and don't look at them. But it's like,
so I have a friend and she's a pastor's wife. Mm-hmm. And it was stormy out here one night and there was a man, and I figured out who she was telling me the story about. Mm-hmm. But there was this guy and he's homeless. And he's in a wheelchair.
Yeah.
And she said, I was not going to let him sit out there in the rain. And I was like, what did you do? I was like, what do you mean? I was like, who did you call? She's like, no, I put him in my car. And I put his wheelchair in my car. And I went and found somewhere for him to stay. And I was like, that's not safe. I said, you should have called somebody to come help you. She's like, I don't care. She's like, I was not going to drive by and not do anything. I was not going to not help.
Well, that's Christ. That is Christ-like.
But you know what? But it's easier. And it was, and it literally, so she ended up getting bed bugs in her car.
Oh.
Yeah. And so she had to strip all her clothes. She had to, and she had to read. And not once did she complain or anything.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing about it. The only reason I heard about her car is because someone told me.
Hmm.
And then when I called and talked to her, I was like, are you okay? I was like, don't you think you should have, you know, called for help? And, you know, we could have all... No, she's fine. She's like, I handled it. I did it. And you know what? And I'm just not sure. You know, I'm not sure why not everybody's hearts are like that. It's confusing. But that's really all I can't even imagine what anybody needs to do. Other than don't turn a blind eye and be kind and be helpful. I mean, and don't go to concerts that say that they're fundraising because it's a crock of shit. Or don't give money to nothing's happening. So why are people giving money?
Yeah.
I'm sorry to the people that hear it and are fundraisers or say they give money, but I just don't know where the money goes. You know, I don't. Yeah. It doesn't make sense to me.
I don't blame you. It really doesn't.
I mean, when I see the prison systems, when I see them when I see the rates going, the rate of people in there going down, then maybe I'll think that, you know, they're actually helping, but they're not. You know, you can drive out there and see that they're at full capacity, all of them.
Yeah.
And we have tons of them here in Texas. I mean, we have more than anyone in the state.
So is there anything that he likes to do other than, like, anything outdoorsy he likes to do that, like, helps calm his spirit?
Yeah, so we go out to our farm and he'll, you know, he'll take the side-by-side and go out and he'll take pictures and, mm-hmm. you know, he loves nature. I mean, he loves his dog, he loves nature, and he loves being outside. And you know, the sad thing is that he loved fishing. He loved to fish and hunt, and he'd go out to the, you know, to the deer lease with all the guys and hang out. And but there's no way on earth you're going to catch him killing an animal. Mm-hmm. It's not going to happen. He's always been compassionate, even as a little kid. Mm-hmm. But now it's just like, oh my gosh. A couple of days ago, he doesn't really get on social media. Mm-hmm. And he does not watch news. He doesn't Google stuff. He really never even really knows what's going on in the world.
Mm-hmm. But it's for the best.
Yeah, well, had a lot of company over. And everybody was talking about the situation in Minneapolis. Mm-hmm. And he came and asked me if I watched the video. And I said, no, absolutely not. I said, I've heard so much. I can't even imagine, you know. Mm-hmm. And he's like, no, you don't even understand. And for someone that never really talks, mm-hmm. when he said that, and I was like, please tell me you did not watch that video. He's like, it's everywhere.
It is.
I was like, why? I was like, why would you do that? He was on the verge of crying, and I'm like, please, no, no, because, you know, I mean, that's a horrible video. It's a horrible thing that happened. And, you know, for someone that has so much compassion and literally can't control it, and more than likely, you know, I mean, something like that can trigger someone's depression, a heartbeat, and I mean, clinical depression. And then that's it. You're stuck in a state, you know, you're stuck in it for 2-3 weeks at the most. So anyway, I can go on for days about how I feel about all this.
So I mean, in closing, do you have anything else you want to like put out there?
No, not really.
Is there anything you want to promote that will help you and your son?
I just want everyone. Yeah, I want to promote that everybody don't turn a blind eye and you know, be helpful. Be there for your family. I mean, the biggest recovery and the success of this has a lot to do with family connection. And it doesn't have to be blood. You know, your family can be anybody, right. But you got to have, you know, if you know somebody going through something, you got to be there for them, you know. Don't wait till you get to that phone call and, you know, and they've committed suicide or they, God only knows what. Because mm-hmm. it's preventable. It is preventable. I think that is preventable.
Yeah.
You never know. I might be proven wrong one day, but.
Yep.
So from the mom to everybody.
From be cool to each other.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you.
And watch anime.
Yes. Yes, especially the Miyazaki ones. Princess Monoki. What's this? Kiki. What?
Stop. Hold on. I went too far.
Miyazaki. Let me see. Okay, what Okay. Okay, what movies? We got Spirited Away. My Neighbor Totoro. Howl's Moving Castle and Princess Mononoke. Yes. Very good. Very good. Well written. Very well animated movies.
I only watch the Weather Channel.
Of course. That's my favorite anime, too.
I'm not kidding. I can't watch anything on TV. The drama, I have enough in my world.
Right.
I watch the Weather Channel.
Have you at least watched Death Note? Death Note is very suspenseful.
What's Death Note?
It's basically this kid finds a demon's notebook that has the power to kill people in however way he writes in it. Like, let's say he wants someone to die of like a car crash, he'll write their name and boom.
Yeah, I want to know the writer's life first.
Yeah, there's Assassination Classroom, which is kind of a comedy sort of thing.
Is that what you watch?
There's one of the classics is Akira. Akira, that's one of like the ones that really started it all, kinda. Of course, there's Sailor Moon, but you know that's for the girls. You know, there's Dragon Ball Z, which a lot of people like.
I've heard of that.
Yeah, Pokemon. That's
from the 90s.
Yeah, Pokemon. That's technically an anime.
Really?
Yes. It's animated in. It was made in Japan.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, the cartoon was. Yeah, you're right. Yeah. That's why I never liked it.
Yeah.
No, that shit's overstimulating. You know that, right? It's too overstimulating for your brain. I'm just saying.
Well, not for mine. I mean, I like
it. It's extremely overstimulating. So do you watch them all the time?
Not all the time, but you know, if someone suggests one that has like a good story, like there's this one called Tokyo Ghoul. I kind of like it. I like a good storytelling.
I'm reading Mike Lindell, the My Pillow guy. I'm reading his book.
Yeah, isn't it basically the Bible?
No. he was on crack. Like, he was straight up a crackhead. Like, yeah. He was hooked on crack.
That explains the pillow, because it's like, you know, I used to sleep on wadded up newspapers. And I realized I could do better. And I cleaned myself up.
No, he was a functioning addict.
Oh, he was a functioning addict.
I mean, it wasn't easy. Yeah, because, I mean, he wasn't a homeless crackhead. He was he always had a home and, you know, he always, you know, he always provided. And
then why did he stop? I mean, you know, no one likes a quitter. No one likes a quitter. Like, come on. Well, we're getting off topic. So let me end the show before it gets all freaking silly. People are like, damn it, Louis B, you fucked another one up again. All right. So anyways, I'd like to thank everyone for listening to the show. I'd like to thank Christy Marie for coming on. And remember, like she says, be cool to each other. Do not turn a blind eye, because, you know, you got to help people. So, as always, from my house to your house, mahalo. And
that's the end of my show, donk.
Mother, let me become a man for sure.